We introduce you now to James Nettesheim.
Thank you very much. That was very nice. You already know, my name is James Nettesheim. I work with Mandiant. Aren't you familiar with us? We get to work a lot of the breaches that you see in the news and a lot of the ones you don't see in the news as well. So we get to kind of have a lot of insight into the attacks that are happening today out there in the industry. This is a big group, so this will be an interesting survey maybe. How many people in the last 6 months to a year have received a data breach notification letter saying your personal information was potentially compromised? Sounds about right. So what's fun about my job sometimes is I get to find my own information and send myself that letter. So that can always be fun. It makes it a little bit more personal while you're digging into it at the same time. So one of the things I wanted to talk about are kind of our review of all the breaches we worked in 2014 and the lessons learned from those. Kind of an overview of the threat landscape and how that impacts everyone from the Fortune 100 companies to the small businesses, to the universities, to the governments, and things like that. Talk a little bit about how to prepare for an attack. I'll present a case study of a recent breach we've worked, and how they got in, what they were able to steal by getting in, and what they were able to do about it. And then we can kind of go through some lessons learned, and hopefully leave you guys a little bit better prepared for if that bad phone call comes someday with the breach. So first, to kind of get into the numbers a little bit, what I love about this chart is it basically just shows everyone's a target. There isn't any industry out there that's not a target right now. And they're a little hard to see the numbers, but several upticks we saw were business and professional services being targeted, healthcare, and a new thing that I'm sure everyone's seen in the news as well is higher education. So universities in particular have been targeted. One, because they're a little bit easier of a target, but also they've realized the amount of information they have, both in research and human, personally identifiable information. Media and entertainment dropped a little bit, even though we had several high profile breaches, such as Sony and things like that, that happened last year. So how are all these companies finding out that they're breached? Only about 31% are realizing they've been breached through their own internal security practices. Most of them were, from an external notification. Brian Krebs, sometimes when we're working an investigation, we'll notice that someone's connecting from another company into this company, and we'll provide the notification. A lot of times it's also law enforcement saying, we've seen your data on this server that we're monitoring, you might want to look into it. And that always leads to a lot of interesting discussions as well as to where it came from and how they got. Now, with these companies being compromised, how long are the attackers typically in there? The median time for last year was 205 days. That's a little over 6 months that attackers are having access to computer networks. To kind of put that in perspective, besides doing forensics and incident response, I also try to do penetration testing from time to time because that gives you a really good perspective on how to get into networks. And it typically takes us about a week to get in and steal all the data that was as part of our engagement plans. So when you have advanced attackers with 6 months access to the network, oftentimes they know the network better than you do by the end of it. They know where all your data is, they know where your admins are connected to, and who to, and how to remotely access the network. We had one client who was compromised for 2,982 days. So that was a little over 8 years that someone had complete access to their network. Probably they had access to their network longer than most of the IT people that work there. So in circumstances like that, there's not too much you can do besides try to completely rebuild the entire time network. One of the main reasons, as I'm sure everyone hears a lot about phishing, is that's when you get sent an email that's specifically targeted to you to facilitate that access to the network. We're seeing 78% of the phishing emails that we find are often from pretending to be from your IT or security team. This is another thing we do during penetration testing. We say, hey, we're doing a password strength survey. Enter your password into this web form that we've created, and you might win a free Apple Watch. Or free iPhone or something like that. Without fail, normally someone's going to do it, and you know, it'll say you successfully, your password is now secure, and then we're able to access the network. Just a simple thing. They know when we're working. Most of the phishing emails are sent during weekdays and during working hours, so that you have less time to respond to the incident. So even if someone gets in and you see that phishing email, if it takes you days to respond to it, that's all that the attack needs. Sometimes they only need an hour or two to be able to move laterally, and then they own your network entirely. So now that we kind of have an overview of what you know the numbers look like a little bit, let's talk a little bit about the threat lines. There's a lot of different threats out there, of course, on the internet. One of the ones, you know, kind of like in the glory days of information security in the early 2000s is more of the nuisance threat, you know, the spam threat, the I love you virus, the SQL spammerworm, that you know, propagated throughout the computer networks of all these major corporations with almost no attack involvement whatsoever. These are automated. They're you know, botnets, they're spam. They're normally part of a bigger plan, but they're not targeted. We also have what's the buzzword nowadays, you know, APT, Advanced Persistent Threat. And that's where you have a nation state who's trying to gain some economic or political advantage. You know, it's espionage, it's a company trying to make your products or something like that. So they're very targeted, very persistent. And that's what I would really strive to stress here is, it's not so much the advanced part that's the hardest part about it, it's the persistent part. Because they're constantly trying and they're never giving up. And once they get in and you kick them out, they're going to try to come right back as well. So you also have the cyber crime groups. These are the people who are trying to steal your credit card, your personal health information, your other personally identifiable information. And they're looking simply to make profit. They're organized crime. They're you know, maybe a kid in a basement. It can be a lot of different tactics, but they're financially motivated. So they're going after things that they can make money off of. We also have hacktivism, which is something like the anonymous group that everyone's heard of. And especially talking to you guys, I want to stress that. This reminds me of a, I think it was in 2014, there was a Boston Children's Hospital in Massachusetts. Was involved in a dispute with some parents about care for a child, and Anonymous didn't like how the hospital had responded, or how the state government or local governments had responded to this. So they started attacking their networks. So a lot of times folks think, well, we're not going to be targeted by an attack like this because we don't do the sort of work that will drive their issues. But you really never know. You really never know what is going to be the hot buzz news topic that's going to get someone interested in potentially trying to embarrass you by attacking the computer network. And the great thing about that case was they ended up attacking the wrong networks. Because you know they're not an intelligence organization out there with targeters telling them to attack this server. They're just looking for servers out there and attacking them somewhat randomly at times. And finally, we have it's a little difficult to see the network attack groups. And those are the groups that you know somewhat everyone heard of Sony with a lot of their workstations being you know. Wiped clean and attacked. Probably a little fewer people have heard of Saudi Aramco, which several years ago they had a remote worm put into their computer network that erased the hard drives of 30,000 computers. And you know, lots of hypothesizing could be as who was responsible for that attack. Typically, it's another nation state or you know someone with nation state backing that has the capability and the desire to cause a disruption. You don't see that a lot with the people who are looking to steal data or financial crime, because obviously it's very noisy. But it's normally someone wanting to make a point, but who's also got you know, some of that nation state level backing. So why are these targeted attacks different? The main differentiator is there's a human at the keyboard and not the other. There isn't, you know, it's not simply you know, an automated virus that's spreading through your email system. They're highly tailored, they're targeted at you, they've done some research into your network, and they've tailored that attack to try to reach your network. It can be nation state or state sponsored, it doesn't have to be. It's, you know, that's what you most often hear about, but it doesn't have the mission statement of the sponsor. There's a division of labor. Just like we do in our day-to-day jobs, we have specialists who focus on certain things that they also do. They have people who focus on getting into the network, people who focus on moving lateral, people who focus on stealing data. And they will escalate between these different groups of talent. If say your network's proving to be a little more difficult, they will send it on to the next group who's using a bit more advanced technology. And that's why a lot of times with these advanced attacks, you're not seeing super sophisticated entry methods, because they don't need to most of the time. They're looking for the lowest, easiest way to get into the network. And their goal is long-term optimization. They have very sophisticated persistence tools. They will relentlessly focus to maintain persistence. They won't just install backdoors. They will try to get VPN access to your network. They will try to get what looks to be legitimate access to your network. So this is what makes it so hard to deal with at the same time. Very good. So just two that we like to focus on are those cyber criminals who more target that PII and financial data. They sell your information for profit, and then that advanced persistence threat, who are really after your technologies, processes, and expertise. They're really focused on potentially improving their domestic industry's capabilities, which also makes almost anyone in any room a target sometimes. If you have a business that someone else wants to set up, then they're interested in your business potential. And then you're a target. And the interesting thing we've noticed, a lot of people have seen in the news with things such as OPM or some of the healthcare insurance breaches, ADT seems to be targeting the personally identifiable information. So there's a lot of hypotheses about why they're targeting that information. Are they trying to gain some sort of intelligence perspective, what's going on? But we've seen them targeting that where we previously haven't seen them targeting. So anyone who has large databases of information about people can oftentimes be targeted by these top level groups as well. So, this is my little scorecard for everyone, so hopefully no one throws anything at me during this. I'll start with the top, with the guys getting the good grades. Aerospace defense, you typically see as very well defended, B or B plus type level. Financial services, also very well defended, because these organizations have been attacked for decades almost, and have had to a higher level of security, and they have stuff to lose, and it's very imperative that they have stuff that people are after. Interestingly, high tech and IT isn't always that good. You would hope they would be, but they haven't had to focus on it like other industries have. So they oftentimes have a very weird mix of technologies in play, with a weird combination of a culture that wants everything to be open and accessible, which makes it a lot easier for the attacker to access. Then we have retailers who, unfortunately, though they've been attacked for a number of years, their networks aren't that well defended today either. They have the PCI DSS framework that everyone follows, of course, but unfortunately it hasn't been able to stay ahead of the attackers and being able to breach data and steal things such as credit card information. Healthcare, we've all seen the breaches recently. Insurance companies aren't normally at the deep sort of level, but especially hospitals with the focus on patients and doctors first and remote access and things like that has made securing the networks pretty difficult. And then, this isn't revenge for having to stay up all night programming or anything in university, but education and higher level universities, we've had to work several of those breaches recently, and F is unfortunately the only grade we could come up with. Things such as professors saying, well, I want to set up a honeypot, but then just plugging it into your regular network and letting people attack. And I'm not sure that's what a honeypot actually is. It's just a compromised web server. Or domain controllers that you can remotely access from home and things like that. So everyone's getting better, though, and focusing on a lot of things. Then government, I couldn't really give a solid grade there because it really does depend so much. Some state and local groups are really far along, some are still working their way towards the federal government. Things like defense are really, really well defended. Things like, unfortunately, we have these. So we'll have to. So why do a lot of people still struggle with securing their networks and what we see after the breaches. So oftentimes, there's been very limited security technology. It's been a box checking exercise. You have to have this device, you have to have this device plugged in, carry on, we've passed all of it. Not a lot of detection and response tools, and if those are in place, a lot of times they're maybe generating a million alerts an hour or something like that. One of my personal pet peeves is if anyone ever tells you their network's being attacked 10 million times a day, I probably wouldn't listen to them longer. Because that's just a way of trying to scare people based on an alerting mechanism that's not really giving you a great idea about what your network's actually experiencing attack. And that comes down to limited security staff. You know, oftentimes security teams are small and there's limited support for them as well. It's getting a lot better. You know, every breach in the news kind of brings it to the forefront. So that's definitely getting a little bit easier for people to solve that challenge. We also have a very reactive security funnel. You wait for that FBI notification, you wait for Brian Krebs to call you, and then you start getting in. But as we all know, that's a little too late most of the time. Once they're in, they're probably already taking what they want. And immature incident response programs. One of these, I was recently on a penetration test where they found my phishing email that I found. I already had access to the user's computer, so I was checking their email. And they sent an email saying, we want to change the password and scan the computer for the antivirus software. Well, they changed the password, so I just grabbed the password again. And then their antivirus scan didn't catch. If there was any sort of amount of sort of incident response or someone looking at that machine a little more closely, they would have found that backdoor. But because it was a very check this box, change the password, check this box, scan the antivirus, we're all clean, they weren't able to find the backdoor and we were able to continue. So other common things for things such as the people that were kind of lower on the grading scale there, historically security isn't a priority, it's becoming a priority. Things like everyone in this room, I think, is a great sign of how much security is a priority for different organizations out there, so that's a great sign to see. A lot of unique challenges, though. People's lives are at risk in hospitals, and obviously that comes first. Sometimes, medical equipment is even networked nowadays, so CAT scanners or MRI machines. So obviously that scares me as a security person, but I understand that availability is what really matters for those devices. With everyone becoming much more connected, there's a huge remote user base nowadays. Everyone has phones that are connected to the networks. They're able to VPN in, so you can work from home, you can work from vacation. But that also opens up a huge attack surface. And then things such as the open culture stuff. We go in sometimes to do, not to pick on universities, but to do security reviews, and we're told you can't even look at the professors. Obviously, that hinders finding or hunting for ever finding that attacker, because when you're cutting off a huge portion of your user base, that's probably the most targeted. You're not going to be less successful. And just, as I'm following on to that, just the rapid expansion. Oftentimes, we don't know everyone who has access to our network, especially once it's sufficiently large. Large companies acquire small companies, companies merge, gaps never fully get closed off. You create an exception for one person because they're working remotely and you never close that off. So it's really just a really difficult thing to secure, especially when security is often an afterthought of the technology. It's not built into the technology. So trying to kind of hold security on computers, which unfortunately doesn't work too often. So, how are attackers getting into networks? And hopefully everyone can kind of see this. So, it follows a pretty standard outline here. You have your initial compromise. You have that initial dish that compromises a web server or an SQL server or something like that. And then they establish their foothold. They'll try to install a back door. They'll try to make sure that they have persistent access to the network just in case they go home for the night or something like that. Then they're going to steal their valid user credentials and try to escalate privileges. Then they're going to go into a loop of trying to identify their target data and steal that data from the network. And then they're going to, eventually, it's kind of a little difficult to hear, they're going to complete their engagement, you know, package any data they want, and leave their engagement. Oftentimes, we get involved during that major loop, or after the loop has already completed, and we see attackers, sometimes they just come back to the network every 3 months to dump the new passwords. They're not actively stealing anything, but they want to maintain access to the network because they've stolen all the data they want, and they'll just want to make sure they have access to it. So, how do they get their initial point of compromise? External facing servers are still targeted constantly. One thing I really hark on is single factor VPN access. You know, it's 2015, almost 2016. There's so many good two-factor solutions out there that I can't stress that enough that you should try to have two-factor remote access. Spear phishing emails, that's just a hard problem to solve. You really need a robust security team to try to analyze them and hoping your users report them to you a lot of times. And then you just have to kind of drive by down. If I want to target healthcare, compromise a healthcare block. And I get that log to try to compromise systems for me. You establish your foothold and you escalate the privileges. So a lot of times they'll start by installing backdoors. They can use anything from custom backdoors to something like Poison Ivy. That's a little that you can download freely out there. We see both of those being used. And then they dump passwords on systems. And this is one of the best ways you can maybe find an attacker in your environment. Look for your event logs, look for executables on the file system that are dumping passwords so that you can identify that someone's doing something in your memory. They move laterally, they have valid credentials. They use the standard Windows tools. Of course, Windows is meant to move laterally, so they'll use those tools. I go into a lot of networks where they tell me something like PSExec, which is assist internal tools to execute software on remote machines, isn't allowed. Tell me, carte blanche is not allowed. If you find it, it's bad. We turn out someone is using it half the time. Or it turns out the attackers are often using it. So if you're not allowing it, then maybe we can take some steps to actually block it so that it doesn't work. Policy oftentimes isn't enough to block things like that. They perform internal recon. They look for network documentation. They look for your privileged users. I think, a common thing is we hunt sysadmins. That's what attackers like to say. You want that system administrator's password because oftentimes they have a lot of access and it's not very easy to monitor. And of course, databases. Another way people find internal breaches a lot of times is the database administrator says, "I'm not running this query that's been running for 3 days. It's taking all of our data and I'm packaging it up somewhere." And that's where you find out you have an issue. So, talk about the backdoors a little bit. Almost always, though, nowadays, the attackers try to switch to legitimate remote access, either via VPN or Citrix or something like that. And that means that they can routinely access your systems in the future without you ever noticing it because it looks just like standard user interactions or activity. And finally, they complete the mission. Like I said, they harvest the data and they transfer stolen data. So, the kind of fun part, let's not skip over, is an actual breach that we recently learned. So, unfortunately, it's a little difficult to see, I think, but it started up in the upper left-hand corner. This was the earliest evidence we could find. It was the attacker accessing the VPN. They had valid credentials to the VPN, and that was the earliest access we saw. We don't know if they phished someone to get those credentials. Very likely. We don't know if someone had used those credentials somewhere else and they had those valid credentials. That happens a lot as well. They read different passwords. But they came in and they accessed the VPN. So they did not have two-factor access on themselves. So all they needed was the username and password and they were able to connect. They were then able to go to a Citrix server, which was in isolated, kind of like jailed environment, so that you weren't supposed to be able to get out. There's a kind of a hobbyist movement out there of jailbreaking and getting out of Citrix boxes. So they were able to use one of these jailbreaks to get out of the Citrix environment. So that basically means if your Citrix environment says you can use Internet Explorer on it or something like that. But then they don't stop you from, in the Internet Explorer toolbar, going to see Windows 32cfd.exe and executing a command prompt, and then you have complete command prompt access. So that's how they oftentimes will get out of these environments so that they can do things other than just browsing. So once they had broken out of the Citrix environment, they had access to the internal. And that's when they had valid credentials, and you can use tools out there once you're inside the network to kind of force authentication to come through your system. So you're getting all these hashes that are coming across your network. So you're not getting the clear text passwords, but you're getting the hash NTLM V2 hashes that Microsoft sends around for authentication. On a recent penetration test I was on, we got a similar route through the VPN. We were able to force this authentication to come to us, and within 8 hours, we were able to crack about 100 passwords because they weren't quite long enough or weren't quite strong enough to get around our brute force. So they were able to gain credentials and start to dump more passwords on over 200 systems. So once they dumped passwords on 200 systems, they eventually got the main admin access, server admin access, database admin access. They kind of had the keys to the public access. So they installed backdoors on these systems. And sometimes you wonder, why would you do that? Why would you install a backdoor on your VPN access? It's just that persistence idea, again. You want to maintain access. So it's a little, that's oftentimes when we find them also, is we find those backdoors first. And then we trace that back to a VPN user or something installing data. They accessed 75 different database servers and harvested personal health information from them. So they were able to steal a large amount of health information. And then they were able to transfer files out of the environment to their So they did this all in 3 months. They touched 500 systems. They only installed malicious software on 6 of them, but they interacted with 500 systems and dumped passwords or stole data or something of that nature. They obtained password hashes for every user in the environment. So that's what makes remediation really, really difficult, because you basically should assume they know all your users. Without a full password reset, you're not going to be able to completely cut off the network. And you know, they obtained data for on the order of millions of customers. So we came in, we were able to find a lot of this activity, but the victim organization wasn't able to perform any sufficient remediation. They weren't able to reset passwords on all of the users, and they weren't able to implement two-factor authentication. So we killed the backdoors, changed the passwords for the users we thought they had, and you know, 2 weeks later, they come right back in the same way they came in the first time, with VPN user access, and accessed 100 systems and dumped passwords. Luckily, at this time, we were monitoring for this exact activity, saw them come back, and that's when the decision was made. Everyone's password gets changed, and we're implementing two-factor. One organization I had wouldn't implement two-factor or couldn't implement two-factor, but they were able to eventually, within 24 hours, get a form of two-factor installed because the attacker kept on coming back and couldn't change any of those passwords. So they were able to install a certificate on the actual workstations to try to enforce that as a block. And that was successful. But if you can, install two-factor with a token, RSA, or Duo, or something like that, that will force a one-time password along with it at the same time. On another engagement, the client had a host checker that was supposed to confirm if you were on a legitimate host given to you by your IT administrators. Within about a day, we found 3 different ways that we could bypass the host checker. So while it's helpful, it still doesn't make me sleep that much better. So what are some lessons learned here? You really want to identify and secure your critical data, data encryption, minimize your access. Logging and alerting is huge. You have to have someone looking at those logs and those alerts as much as possible. You want to install that two-factor. I know I've talked a lot about it, but it's just, there's two technologies out there that are really good at keeping attackers out. There's one, network-level blocking, two-factor authentication. And that's one thing we see consistently get in the way of attacking when we're trying to get it. We want, and then, you know, kind of as I said there, that network segmentation. One thing that really slows people down is, say they get onto a workstation or a Citrix environment, they shouldn't be able to get to their internal network as the next stop. They should have to go through several other hops to get there. So your database server should be walled off with only access from certain systems now. Same with your domain controller. And only domain admin should be able to log on. It's, you know, it's a bit of work, of course, I understand, but it's the only way to really try to identify them once they're in. Because it's not about keeping them out forever. It's about identifying that initial access and kicking them out before they've ever gotten to anything and knowing where they went because you have knowledge of them on the track. So application whitelisting on any of your critical systems is always great. If you install it on a workstation, it's even better. The more logging or the more controls you have, the better. You know, protect your Proteus accounts. Maybe use an account safe, if you will, so that all the access to certain accounts has to go through these systems out there that audit and confirm potentially with two-factor access that you are who you say you are. And the proactive hunting for evidence of compromise. Really need someone going through and looking for, is anyone dumping passwords? Is anyone moving laterally that shouldn't be? Is someone logging into the VPN from New York and Sydney at the same time? That probably should be. So that sort of proactive hunting, trying to find people using your system. And along with that goes that enhanced incident response process. And that AV scan, unfortunately, isn't going to find most custom backups. And you want to focus on the people in the processes first. You want to get the right people in place in the right processes. Those are the most important things. Then you, after you have those people and processes in place, you want to implement the technology and solve the solution. You have to remain secure. And then finally, kind of with everything out there, execution always trumps strategy. You can have the best plan in the world, but if you don't practice it, if you don't make sure everyone knows who to call and what to do in certain instances, it doesn't help too much. So you have to make sure you can execute it the right way. So I think it was about right, about 10 minutes for questions. If anyone has questions.
We've had text messages with questions. First one is, some IT companies in Europe are already using hardened authentication as an alternative to third factor who you are for banking, since fingerprint data is now being compromised. Have you heard about this, and if so, what are your thoughts?
I haven't seen anyone, did you say heartbeat authentication? Heartbeat authentication. I haven't seen anyone using that currently. I haven't seen anyone attack biometric systems either. I don't see them too often in place. So I can definitely take that for research and get back to you on it. But I haven't seen anyone implement that.
What is your recommendation for the minimum length of a password and how often to change it?
Well, that's always a my recommendation would be use two-factor first, then every 90 days, 14-character password, specifically complex, or teach your users to use, you can lower the complexity requirements if they use more passphrase type things, so that they're a lot longer and easier to remember for at the same time. But personally, I found two-factor is great because it makes passwords easier to remember. A lot of people, once they get used to it,